to start this evening's meeting for September the 19th. First, we'll have the invocation by one of our chaplains. I'm sorry, I don't have your name in front of me.
Stevens, Gloria.
Pastor Stevens. And then we will have the Pledge of Allegiance by one of these young men right here. It was a Cub Scout Pack 217. All right, let's start off, and then we'll have the roll call. Let's start off with the invocation. Please stand.
Mayor, officials, and each one of you, I greet you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. It's once more and again, dear Heavenly Father, you've allowed us to assemble ourselves, to come into your presence. First, we want to thank you that in spite of whatever property damage or whatever has gone on, it is well with our soul. We thank you, Lord, for where you brought us from to where we are. We thank you for this blessed opportunity to come in your presence, to do what you have assigned to our hands and to our hearts. We pray to Heavenly Father for all the families and all those that's gone through any type of situations as far as this hurricane is concerned. So bless us as we come forth to do your will, your way, according to your word. It's in the Master's wonderful name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. All right. Pledge, young man.
Okay. I'm a pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America
and to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God, indivisible, and with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
Good job. Good job.
Commissioner Grogan?
Here.
Commissioner Wilson?
Here.
Mayor Johnson?
Here.
Commissioner Furstner?
Here.
Commissioner Keller?
Here.
All right, we're going to have the presentations by the Ocoee Police Department. Police Chief Charlie Brown.
Mayor, Commissioners, thanks for having us here tonight to recognize our officers. We're going to go ahead and start with the CACOPD. Victoria Laney is going to recognize Eduardo Hernandez. If you'd come to the front. Cool.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Commissioners, Mr. Frank. I'd like to introduce Eduardo Hernandez. He's raised here in the city of Ocoee and graduated from Ocoee High School. He attended our first joint public safety academy, which was held with the Ocoee Police Department and Fire Department. He was hired as a cadet for the Ocoee Police Department in 2015 after he graduated the University of Central Florida. Officer Hernandez was offered the full sponsorship to Lake Tech Institute of Public Safety, and upon his successful completion began his career as a patrol section in the patrol section of our department, assigned to one of our midnight squads. Officer Hernandez is bilingual in Spanish, and he currently lives in Ocoee with his family.
Excellent. And so we selected him as Officer of the Quarter based on several really wonderful actions he took. On March 28, 2017, Officer Hernandez and other officers located several transients living out of their vehicles and panhandling at our local Walmart. He informed them of our new panhandling ordinance in the city and told them that they had to be registered to panhandle. He gave them directions and advice on how to seek assistance from our Christian Service Center and Matthew's Hope for homeless people in order to get services and receive assistance to get them back on their feet. On April 4th, 2017, Officer Hernandez was informed by a local business that unknown persons were living in a vehicle behind their business and that employees were afraid to come to work in the early morning hours. Officer Hernandez made it a top priority to locate this person and found out that he was an employee of another local business and that he had recently become homeless. Officer Hernandez took the time to talk with this person. He saw an open bottle of alcohol in the vehicle, and he learned that alcohol had been a negative influence on his life and really the cause of his problems. Officer Hernandez told him not to give up and that he could find help online or through his family. Officer Hernandez showed compassion and caring while still enforcing the law. On April 6, 2017, Officer Hernandez noticed a series of burglaries that had occurred on or about April 4th through April 5th at a nearby apartment complex. Officer Hernandez was very concerned about the burglaries and stated that he was going to do his best to stop anyone from committing burglaries. No more burglaries. He stated he was going to tell every citizen he came into contact with to be mindful of their property and make sure they locked all their doors. Officer Hernandez made contact with seven persons throughout his shift that night and spoke to them about the importance of locking their vehicles and removing valuables from sight. On April 7th, 2017, officers discovered a burglary in progress at Walmart. Officer Hernandez saw the vehicle as it was fleeing the scene, and he used safe driving tactics, but he still kept the vehicle in sight, and he saw that it was driving towards Tiger Minor Park. And he said, aha, I've got a chance to stop this vehicle using the stop sticks that the city of Ocoee provides for the police to use. And these have spikes in them, so you put them down in the road, and you know they can either stop before or they're gonna stop after because their tires are all gonna be flat. And so he successfully deployed the stop sticks. This made the vehicle stop and turn away, you know, running on its, you know, rims. It turns away and it backs towards an unpopulated area with no other vehicle traffic. And thanks to the quick thinking of Officer Hernandez, vehicle pursuit was avoided and the suspects were taken into custody in an area without a lot of other people around, no need for any, you know, no injuries. Everything was totally resolved. All the stolen property was recovered and returned to Walmart. This award is being given to Officer Hernandez by the Citizen Advisory Council for the Ocoee Police Department members. Officer Hernandez's dedication, actions, and a job well done are richly rewarded. Congratulations to you, Officer Hernandez, on being the Ocoee Police Department's Officer of the Second Quarter of 2017. Receiving this nice pin that he can wear to show that he was honored as Officer of the Quarter, and he also gets a nice certificate and some other nice things too.
All well deserved.
Thank you, Victoria. If I could, I'd like to bring up special guests. Let's start with Chief Dave Ogden from the Windermere Police Department. And Windermere Officer Robbie Harrison and Ocoee Officer Brian Harris. If y'all would come to the front. I'm gonna read a short bio on Officer Harris, then we're gonna recognize them for valor and their bravery. And Chief Ogden will be able to read a bio or introduce Officer Harrison. Officer Brian Harris was raised in Ocoee and a graduate of West Orange High School. Officer Harris was a member of the Ocoee Police Department Explorer Program. He started his law enforcement career at the Ocoee Police Department in January 2007 after his graduation from Valencia Community College's Criminal Justice Institute. Upon his start with the department, Officer Harris was assigned to the patrol division while working as a patrol officer. He had an interest in becoming a member of the traffic unit and enforcing DUIs. He successfully attended and completed several traffic-related training courses, and in 2013, he processed for and was awarded position on the City of Ocoee Traffic Division as a traffic homicide investigator and DUI enforcement officer. Starting in March of 2014, Officer Harris began taking DUI-related training courses to further his education in DUI investigation, and in 2017 became a drug recognition expert, a DRE. There are only 19 certified DRE officers in the entire Central Florida area. Officer Harris has received various awards throughout his career to include the top producer for Click It or Ticket campaign, Officer of the Quarter, and is a five-time recipient of the Mothers Against Drunk Drivers Award for Excellence for DUI enforcement. And if Chief Ogden would introduce Officer Harrison.
Sure, thank you. Good afternoon, Mayor and Commissioners and folks of the town, city of Windermere, or I'm sorry, Windermere, Ocoee. So easy to say Windermere. If I could, very quickly first, I want to say we've enjoyed an excellent working relationship with the Ocoee Police Department and the individuals here, not only the chief, but the police officers. Most recently, in a Hurricane Irma, as well as our police officers had to relocate to the Ocoee Police Department for the 2 or 3 days when the windstorms were so strong. So I want to really publicly make that thank you to Chief Brown and his officers, because we have enjoyed a super, super working relationship. Officer Robbie Harrison is a graduate of the Seminole County Community College. He came to the Windermere Police Department not quite, just under 6 years ago, and he's been an outstanding officer for us. As soon as he came to the police department, within the first year of talking to him, I asked him what his goals and his objectives were. And one of those was to become an expert in DUI enforcement. He was a personal advocate of enforcing DUIs because of a personal situation that happened in his life. Robbie set on a course of action to become a DRE, the first DRE, drug recognition expert, for the Windermere Police Department. And over the course of the next 3.5 years, took the basic DUI course, the advanced AROD course, and then now the drug recognition course, which is where he's getting partial of this award when he was in Jacksonville just a few months ago. We're extremely proud of Deputy Harrison and his accomplishments and what he's done. For a small agency with only 13 members in the police department, as Chief Brown just indicated, there was only 19 drug recognition experts in all of Central Florida, and we are very proud that we possess one of them. So I wanted to introduce Deputy Robbie Harrison to you.
All right, so now while we're here, I'd say almost 2 months ago, Chief Ogden, it was brought to our attention that while they were at a school, there was an incident. Chief Ogden has recognized them with the same awards in the city of Windermere. And now I'll read to you the narrative of what happened. On October 16th, 2017, Officer Brian Harris and Windermere Officer Robbie Harrison were in Jacksonville, Florida, attending the Drug Recognition Expert Certification class, the DRE class that we were just discussing. After the day's class ended, they were traveling back to their hotel on Interstate 95 in Officer Harris' patrol vehicle. While on Interstate 95, Officer Harris observed a box truck that had struck a concrete column at an on-ramp overpass. There were a few civilian vehicles that had stopped, but no law enforcement or fire personnel were on scene because this had just happened. Officer Harris activated his emergency lights to protect for further crashes and stopped to assist. When Officer Harris exited his patrol vehicle, he observed black smoke coming from the truck. Therefore, he grabbed his fire extinguisher. When Officer Harris reached the cab of the truck, he observed the back of the driver facing him. Both Officer Harrison and Officer Harris attempted to open the door of the truck. However, it was too crushed from the collision. The cab was beginning to fill with smoke, and Officer Harris could not see the driver anymore. However, he could hear him talking and yelling. Officer Harris then began to spray his fire extinguisher toward the floor of the cab.
Officer Harris began to see an orange glow coming from the floor. He moved to the passenger side of the truck. At that point, he saw that there was also a passenger in the truck. The passenger door was also crushed too much to be open. The passenger began getting burned, and Officer Harris sprayed the rest of the fire extinguisher into the passenger side. After his fire extinguisher ran out, he moved back to the driver's side. The driver had managed to get turned around and was leaning his head and arms out the window. Officer Harris and Officer Harrison attempted to pull the driver from the cab. However, his legs were stuck inside the cab and could not be removed. Both officers began throwing any water from that they could get from passersby, water bottles, any water they could find on the driver. Due to the intense heat and flames, attempts to rescue the occupants were hindered. Officer Harris and Officer Harrison immediately instructed innocent civilians in the area away from the scene to protect their safety. At some point after this, the fuel tank, which had ruptured, began burning very seriously. Local law enforcement and fire department arrived on scene, and the fire department eventually put the fire out. But unfortunately, both drivers and passengers succumbed to the injuries. Officer Harris and Officer Harrison's act of courage and bravery involving the risk and danger to their own life are commendable. Therefore, Officer Harris is being presented with the Award of Valor, and Officer Harrison is being presented with the Chief Special Award from the Ocoee Police Department. Thank you. The officers will receive a ribbon that they can wear on their uniform for 30 days, and then anytime they're in a dress uniform, they can wear that same ribbon. Thank you, Mayor.
Chief, I forgot to mention, Mayor Windermere called me last night, or not for less, and reminded me that he wanted to make sure everybody knew that he was wanted to be here tonight to congratulate him again. They had to call their meeting order tonight because I guess they'd missed the meeting.
Last week.
So he wanted to specifically say that he was real proud of these young men and wanted to thank them personally, so.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. All right. We have another proclamation. I'm gonna bring Commissioner Grogan up front here, and for the chaplain unit for the Blue Jay Way project. Do we wanna play the video first, then I'll read the proclamation, and then I'm going to need to keep one. Yeah. Standing on any of the
getting results. All new at 5, a popular pathway for students in disrepair. We're talking beer bottles, trash, and vulgar graffiti all over.
It is a mess. We're talking about the walkway known as Pig's Alley in Ocoee. That is right behind Spring Lake Elementary School. News 6's Amanda Castro has more on how the community is getting results.
Broken fences, trash on the ground, and graffiti everywhere. This is what parents and their kids see when they're walking to and from school. Now the community wants to get results and clean this alleyway up.
Some good news for you tonight, High Point Church members and volunteers. They got results this morning. They met for a common goal at Spring Lake Elementary School in Ocoee to give this walkway a facelift before the start of school. Now, this alley is referred by a lot of people as Pig's Alley. It's seen better days before this morning. It's a popular route for kids on their way to school. Today, you can check out those volunteers. They swapped that graffiti stained fence with a fresh coat of paint and picked up trash in the area. Now in the future, the fences will adorn inspirational messages as kids head back to school.
My city so cold if you ain't dressed, and what they accept, I had a right address. Parts of my city, certain colors can't step, and sadly I'm talking about the color of your skin. Time my brother can't let you in, cause the property value might go down to a level that's economically unacceptable and socially taboo for us to live around you, huh? Is this what it's down to? Root for the same team, had the same dream, not the same reality. Actually, mine's into bad education and gentrification. Despite all the above, I love this city. Oh, it's my city.
For students in Orange County, and thanks to one group of volunteers, an alleyway has a new look to show off to students who are walking to and from school. We first told you about Pig's Alley in Ocoee a little more than a week ago. For so long, that path located near Spring Lake Elementary was littered with trash and graffiti, but now that mess has turned into a work of art. The fence is now, as you can see, painted blue with a few meaningful messages. And that alleyway now has a new name to go along with the new look. It goes by Blue Jay Way, since the mascot at Spring Lake Elementary is the Blue Jay.
Yep. If we can get the chaplains, Lowe's, yes. All the volunteers to
yeah,
come.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Okay. The Lowe's people, they said on this thing, they'd give $2,500. Is the Lowe's people here?
Yes, yeah.
Also,
everybody,
come on up.
Thank you.
take a lot of pride with the involvement of volunteers, and you can see the what went on here. That's exactly what we had, even with Lowe's and the chaplains and the different departments working on this. I'm going to read this proclamation, and then Commissioner Grogan will give out, read the names off, and call out each one to come get their proclamation. The City of Ocoee Police Department Chaplain Unit took on a project to clean up and restore the old pig trail at Spring Lake Elementary School, now called Blue Jay Way. And whereas the chaplain unit brought people from their respective congregations and local business owners who helped make the project possible by donation or their time and effort. And whereas the chaplain unit and volunteers worked over a two-week period prior to the beginning of the school year so the children could see their new trail on the first day of school. And whereas the chaplain unit went to Blue Jay Way on the first day of school and greeted the students as they made their way to school. And whereas the chaplain unit has made a long-term commitment to maintain Blue Jay Way in the same condition as it was the first day of school. Now therefore, the City Commission of the City of Ocoee does hereby recognize the week of September the 18th through the 24th, 2017, as Ocoee Police Department Chaplain Unit Week, and further extend our appreciation to the entire chaplain unit for the vital services they perform, their hard work and dedication to the City of Ocoee and the citizens they serve. All right, next, I also did it, hang on just a second. The school, is Patty Harrison the principal here?
Yes.
Could you come up too? Also, Marion Campbell. She here?
He's at open house.
Oh, him. Okay. Joseph Corman?
He's at open house.
How about Kaylee?
Yeah, they're all open busy. House tonight. Yeah.
This is the principal, the new principal, matter of fact, of our Spring Lake Elementary School. All right, John?
Sure.
Thank you.
These are copies of the proclamation that we're going to give to all the pastors. So that they can put them up in their churches. And this would be it. David, thank you very much. Margaret, thank you.
You're not going to read each one of his name out, John? You're going to read each one's name out, right?
The pastors, how about I pass the mic and everybody introduce themselves?
Patty Harrelson, principal of the Proud Blue Jays, Spring Lake Elementary.
Christy Strasbaugh, member of the High Point Church.
Greg Buckey from High Point Church.
John Verduin from High Point Church.
These three are the muralists. And if you've ever tried to draw a mural that's 100 feet long, it's not easy, but really appreciate it. I'm Keith Tower. I'm fortunate enough to be their pastor at High Point Church.
Kevin Holmes with Sharon Williams. Proud to be a sales service rep at Lowe's on 642 Orlando.
Mitchell Mack, Lowe's.
Danielle Stasco, HR manager here at Lowe's.
I'm Chuck Brown, the store manager at Lowe's in Ocoee.
I'm David Hartbarger, preacher at the Ocoee Church of Christ. And before I pass this on, Sergeant Maria Iannuzzi, she is the one that I think really got all of this started. She needs special recognition for that.
My name is Gloria Stevens. I'm a citizen here in Ocoee. And I attend church in the Apopka area, but do things everywhere else. Thank you.
I'm Margaret Marquis. I'm the pastor of Ocoee Christian Church, Disciples of Christ.
Hi, my name is Rolando Vargas. I am committee chair for PAC 217 in Ocoee, and High Point Church is our home. And everybody here is part of PAC 217 as well, including Mr. Russell Johnson.
Let's give them another hand. Lowe's, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate all y'all's efforts.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your support. Thank you very much.
We're going to take a 5-minute break. Restart the meeting. We're going down to comments from citizens and public. Anybody in the public want to make any comments, now's the time. That's not anything to do with what's on the agenda. If it's on the agenda, then wait and come up for that. If not, now's the time. Hello. How you doing?
This one or the other? Either one? I guess it's the second one, but I never really worried about it.
Hello, I am Ann Whittle, and I live at 715 East Lakeshore Drive in Sleepy Harbor here in Ocoee. We just did a fantastic preview of the safetiness that was designed for Spring Lake for our kids. And I'm here to ask why, and I know we've gone through a terrible week, and I know that we don't have dress rehearsals. But I left for work yesterday morning and was absolutely appalled that I have watched the entire week the sidewalks along Orlando Avenue have not been cleared by the city. The residents have gotten out and done theirs. There is a tree across the biggest sidewalk that we have the crossing guards on. It also pulled up a big piece of concrete. And our kids were having to go through that to get to school yesterday, and they've been out, counting the weekends, 10 days. They should not have to go through that. On the other side is the small sidewalk. It had trash on the sidewalk, so they would have had to walk out into the street to get to school safely, and I just cannot imagine that you would not get out and at least clean the sidewalks to the schools.
Good comments. Steve? Steve's the Public Works Director.
Nice to meet you, Steve.
And demolition pickup expert now.
Yeah, well, that's another story.
We appreciate all your patience. We have crews running constantly, day trimming everything. We have not been able to address everything, but we're just attacking it as we can.
I understand there is a lot to clean up, but our children's safety is the most important of anything. You had people out assessing. Why wasn't that seen? Why wasn't it cleaned up before the kids started school on Monday?
We actually have been addressing. We started.
My lawn guy moved the tree today, by the way. I have pictures. I was talking to him about it yesterday because he was in my yard cleaning up, and I said it just really upsets me. He went out today and removed the tree. He could not remove the concrete.
Well, we appreciate that, and we'll investigate the concrete, but we are addressing everything as best we can.
So did you not think about the schools starting on Monday and at least get those sidewalks cleaned for all the schools?
That's where we've started. We're still addressing.
I have not seen one person other than two pickup trucks in my neighborhood or in my area the entire time, and they were riding around in a pickup truck. I still say that the sidewalks for the schools were the most important.
I agree.
Before you pick up trash on the side of a road.
I can't express anymore.
Will you go look at the piece of concrete that's still sitting there and has a hole in it that the kids still... I went home last night from my work, and there was a kid actually crossing over the tree and the sidewalk on his bike.
I agree with you, and I know what you're saying, Ms. Whittle, but did you call that in and put that on the phone and report it in just by chance?
No, I did not.
Well, I'm just asking.
I'm not part of the city, and I should not have to look at the city.
You're not part of the city?
I'm part of the city, but not your property.
No, I know that.
That should have been something you were assessing when you went out to figure out everything you needed to do.
I think that should have been seen.
You've
made a point of it. I agree with you. It's just something that I seen that same piece of concrete this afternoon I rode by that was sticking up on Arland Avenue.
Did you report it?
I'm going to report it tonight.
Yeah, tonight. It's been out there for a week.
Well, that's when I'm coming here, but I've been, listen.
It's been there a week, and you're just now reporting it also.
Well, you know, I'm trying to explain to you, you're exactly right. You know, you want to stand up there for another 10 minutes to scream?
No, I do not.
No, go ahead, stand there. I mean, we agree with you. I agree with you.
Then what are you going to do about it?
I think you're going to see it get fixed.
When?
Ask that gentleman right there.
When, Steve?
I'll see if we can send a crew out there tomorrow. We're addressing all 116 miles of streets within the city as best we can.
How many of those 116 miles are close to a school?
Several. We have been working out from them. That's where we're addressing.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
We'll address it as best we can.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
All right.
We have another representative.
I fixed the caller.
Oh, I didn't know if you know.
You want to
take
over?
No, I didn't know if you had seen her.
Will you?
Sorry.
All y'all seem to think, I do read the agenda. If you'll give me a minute, and I'll let Ms. Whittle finish, and then we'll get on. Representative Brown is up to speak. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mayor Johnson. To the distinguished members of the commission, to the citizens, I am here because as a candidate, I ran on a platform of assisting our small businesses with various resources that they needed to thrive. Now that I am currently in office, I want to go ahead and fulfill that promise, as well as work with you as our district continues to grow. We have Ocoee that's thriving and growing, but we also have the Winter Garden area that's growing as well. In accordance with educating the public and empowering our businesses, my office would like to host a small business workshop at the Lakeshore Center on the morning of Saturday, June 20th, 2018, from 9 to 11 a.m. The purpose of this workshop will be to provide educational speakers, materials, as well as resources from our state and local government on how to do business with the various agencies and assist them with those contracting, as well as additional funding. I know we have agreed to work with the West Orange Chamber of Commerce, as well as the other chambers within the area, also the SBA, with providing the resources that are needed to be available for our citizens. Because of limited funds, I am requesting a waiver for the rental of the workshop, because it will be for educating the public. It will be for public use. Pursuant to Florida Statute 11.045, subsection 1C2, based off of that particular statute, I make this particular request. The waiver fee will be used again to help promote this particular event to the public, as well as for the literature and materials that are needed to make sure this event is successful. I appreciate your consideration on this request.
I'll make the first comments. We've already had this once before come before us when Representative Bracey asked to use it and for no charge. We turned it down.
Okay.
We don't even, none of us use it. It's a thing we set up that we won't do that. What we can do is, but the other thing is, that's also the Saturday. That's one of our most important times to rent it out. If people are gonna rent it, it's on Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Mm-hmm. So what I would suggest we have, and I don't, Jeff's here or not, I know Mark Johnson's here, but we have the Vignetti Center, we have the Senior Center, mm-hmm. which is available. It would be just as comparable to use. So we could look at letting that be the place where you could utilize one of those buildings for that function. So now I'll let any of the other commissioners that want to talk on it say anything, but that's, we've made that part of the process. We didn't let Mr. Bracy, Representative Bracy at the time, use it, so we got to stick to it. We don't let ourselves even do it for things like that. So, but we do have, I don't know if you know about the Vignetti Center.
No, but I would love to
say on Adair Street.
Take a look at it. Definitely.
And we also have the Senior Center, which is great.
Okay.
So we can work at either one of those. I think if you, anybody else want to make comments on it? If not, I can, you can get a hold of right next door to your office, matter of fact, and talk to Mark's, okay. Mr. Johnson there, Mark's group, or Jeff, and they can set up and divvy the dates or anything for that building.
Okay, perfect. So, thank you so much.
Do we need a consensus or a vote?
Yeah, if that's what the commission wants to do, if you want to offer one of those facilities,
yeah, and I don't have a problem waiving the fee for that. If you want to use those buildings.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
And we just need a consensus.
Consensus on making
the other.
Yeah.
No problem.
Okay.
That would be no charge. It's just that building work doesn't work that way. So.
Okay.
But that, like I said, the Senior Center, they can let you meet up there and look at it. I think you do. That's a nice place too.
Perfect.
So if you can get a, Mark, you got a card with you or something, maybe.
I don't even think January. I don't think January.
We'll see you.
No. We're fixed to be tearing that part of that out anyway, I think, starting in January.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going to redo it.
Oh, wow. Okay.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
May I say something?
Yeah.
I would like to thank you very much on behalf. I know that I'm with Tri-County League of Cities and we're with the Florida League of Cities, but we thank you so much for your supporting home rule, and I know you were given an award by the Tri-County League of Cities, Florida League of Cities, excuse me, for doing that, and I appreciate your support of what we're doing and what you're doing.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm going to, Ben, she brought that up, I'm going to say something, Mr. Mayor. I don't know if you do all the home rule. I think you need to pay more attention to the home rule.
Okay.
Now, she said that, but I'm going to tell you, you voted on the action for the antennas and all the things on the street. That's not for home rule. That's against us.
Okay.
I'm telling you, as the mayor, not just himself. And I don't know why the Tri-League of Cities, I know that some of us got off supporting somebody because of the exact same reason. It was not, you go up there and people go up there and forget what the cities are. Our city's home rule is what we should be going by. But when people get up there, they go vote for other things and forget about the home rule. But one of the home rule parts was the deal about the antennas or the things that get put on the corners all over town. So that's part of that, I think, has to be addressed.
Absolutely.
And I don't understand why Tri-League City's not doing that either.
Okay.
That's a big part of what's going on up there. They're not adhering to the home rule. And that's what we as a small city have to live by, and we should be living by.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for your comment.
I believe
that's my opinion. And I noticed some other ones that mayors and I go. I'm in the Mayor's Association, and I'm in the small cities for the whole United States with the chairman of this year, and I'm telling you, we fight that all over, but the home rule is where we get hit from. When they go to Tallahassee, they seem to forget what the cities are doing and what we're supposed to be doing, and they seem to rule on whatever the other people want instead of what the home rule is, and that's my...
I agree.
And I believe you did vote against the antennas. If
nope.
I'm correct?
No, did I did. I voted in support of it.
You
but
voted
there were
voted.
Various,
okay.
There were various while sitting on the local affairs committee.
I wouldn't have said that if I wasn't
so,
you.
But yeah. In general, you have been supportive.
Absolutely.
Of what we
and
have
definitely advocated for many, many, many yeah. issues and for many years. So, again, you will continue to have my support this year.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else in the public? All right, staff report.
Mayor, we have two emergency items this evening. Emergency item number one is the disaster debris recovery and removal activation with Saris Environmental Services for the Hurricane Irma debris. What this is, it's a $1.2 million contract to remove all the tree limbs and everything everyone stacked up in front of their house. And we want to activate that tomorrow and start on the debris removal tomorrow. And the portion of that $1.2 million that we incur prior to October 1st, we anticipate transferring some funds from this year's budget into that line item. And that's the second thing that this item does. It lets us take unspent funds in the various different departments, and it gives the authorization to me to transfer those to general government so we can pay those fees prior to October 1st. And the remainder of the contract will be used with the $900,000 you transferred in next year's budget last evening. So we'd ask for your approval on this item.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller, seconded by Commissioner Grogan. Any more comments? Let's vote. Motion carries.
And the second emergency item is the disaster debris monitoring with CPH for item number one. And basically, this is monitoring and verification of the debris collection to conform to FEMA reimbursement requirements, because at some point in the next several years, we would like to get reimbursed for these costs from the federal government. So this item's for $185,758.27, and very similar to the last item. The portion that we incur this year, we would use transferred funds to cover.
Motion. Motion to approve.
Motion second. Made by Commissioner Grogan. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Keller. Any more comments? If not, let's vote.
I have a comment.
Whoop, you want a comment?
Yes, I do.
All right.
What are other options besides this at $185,000?
Well, the first option we had was $450,000.
Yeah. Yeah, I knew that.
Yeah, we pared that down quite a bit. We're going to be using some employees that we've taken from the various departments to help us with the monitoring. We pared it down from like 450 to this 185 by limiting the engineering firms, contractors, to basically monitoring the paperwork that is brought into the site where we're going to collect everything. And we've done some training with the employees that we've selected from around the city, and so they know how to fill out the paperwork. So it's a second check. You know, they're going to be verifying everything and make sure that it conforms to FEMA's requirements. And I think it's a good investment if we really look to get this money back at some point in the future.
This will also be added into the cost of getting the money back too? This is all part of
it. Well, whether they're going to, I mean, we anticipate they would pay for this because they require it. They require some type of monitoring. And so that's what we're doing.
Thank you.
And hopefully we'll get reimbursed for this also, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, let's vote. Motion carries unanimously.
And that's all I have for now, Mayor.
What about the other one here?
That's the latest contract for agenda item number four. That's on the consent agenda. That's just the latest and greatest.
Yeah. All right, Commissioner's announcement. Commissioner Grogan.
I just wanted to thank all those volunteers again for what they've done. There's probably not a year that goes by that I get a few calls on the Blue Jay Lane. I'm glad the name changed. And I think they did a great job. And just in case anybody didn't hear everything, what they're going to do is that once a month, the churches will actually take possession for a month, and every weekend go out there and make sure that it stays clean, make sure the graffiti stays off. So this is a continuous thing throughout the whole year, and hopefully for many years after that. So great job to them, and I thank them very much. That's all I have.
All right, Commissioner Wilson.
Nothing at this time.
Commissioner Forsman.
I just wanted to thank and applaud all the departments and their staffs for getting us through, the whole city, through this hurricane. I went down, I visited the emergency operations center, and it was just running right along. It was well organized, like it always has been, and everybody knew their jobs, and everybody was in place, and it really gave me a lot of confidence that we could handle anything that was coming down the pipe. So, once again, thank you for your efforts and all the work that you did.
Mr. Keller.
I'm just going to echo Commissioner Furster. EOC, the staff, every staff at every department, Public Works, you guys were fantastic. I mean, what did you say? you know, you got all those miles, and somewhere's got to be the start, and somewhere's got to be the finish, and nobody's going to be happy with, unless you started with them. So I just really do appreciate the job you do. I know from some of the calls I had, some of the hardships out there, and it's really rough, especially at the beginning when you have no power and you have these problems with trees and everything else. And you, all of you, just thank you so much for the job you did for the city. Really, really appreciate it. That's all, Mayor.
Mayor, can I just?
Yeah, go ahead.
Steve, while we're talking about the hurricane, the cleanup, can you just give a brief overview so all the citizens will know how we're handling this and how we're going to remove the debris? So
I'd be glad to. The we've activated, what you've approved tonight is a contract with Saris Environmental. They're experts in debris removal. They've designated six crews to the city where we're looking to pick everything up within 45 days. Those six crews are going to make three passes through all the neighborhoods. I don't have enough accurate schedule yet to tell you who's going to start where. So in the next 3 weeks, you should see a crew and have the first pass come through your neighborhood. Well, after that, it'll probably be another 10 days, and they'll make another pass through all the neighborhoods because there'll be less debris, and then a third pass, hopefully by the end, and be done by the end of October with everything. We're going to be working 12-hour days, 7 days a week. We're supplementing 12 people from the city staff from various departments to be monitors out there. We'll be tracking all the debris. We're using a temporary debris site at the end of Klinger Cove Road, which is the west end of Worst Road. We're accessing the former Rogers property, which will be a future park, to use about 10 acres of that 42-acre property to stack up all the material, the vegetative debris. They'll come mulch it, and then we'll be able to haul it off at a less price. The city sanitation team is going to go around. We'll be continuing because we still have a couple claw trucks. They can't handle the loads of the debris, but we're going to take care of the construction, demolition, the building materials, things like that. So if people can, we're encouraging people to separate any vegetative debris from building materials so we can pick those up easier. A lot of people have bagged already. We're telling them just keep the materials in the bags, but anything else you take out the curb to keep it out of a bag. So that's kind of where we're at. We're going great guns. We've been going since last week. Starting tomorrow, you'll see some results of that. And I appreciate everybody's patience. And we are addressing we started with the schools. We are trying to attack everything we can.
11 schools in the city?
Yeah, we got a few. And unfortunately, Blue Jay Way is closed right now. We're waiting on some utility lines that fell to be removed so that we can go in there and remove the trees that are blocking it right now. So there's a lot of
lights up too.
Pardon?
And put some street lights up.
We're working on that, but that's where we're at right now.
Thank you.
It's my turn. So just to thank you, the staff, and I know people get upset about things, and I know she's all well. She's a really nice lady, and one of the things would help sometimes with as much disaster type demolition we had with trees and trash and things that happen. I think any citizen that sees that, please call one of our lines and tell us if it's an emergency area or emergency piece of equipment, that stone like that concrete's up, call us and tell us, because everybody won't see everything. There's so many, if you ride down some of the streets and see some of the devastation, it's just some of the things you can miss. And if a tree was covering that stone, you might not have seen it. And it's not an excuse, it's just things happen. But I will say, with the staff, with all our people that work, they were all working hard and working a lot of hours. And I think that might have been where some of the things slipped by, but I think we're all on board to get it done, and we'll be working that in the next 45 days, right?
Definitely.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you.
All right, consent agenda.
Mayor? Yeah. I'm asking for item number 6 to be removed. That's completed the necessary
forms. You
want
to remove it or pull it?
Pull it.
All right.
And vote on it separately. I have a conflict with two of the programs, the Ocoee Women's Club and the Christian Service Center, and I've completed the forms with my conflict.
All right.
I'll make a motion to approve everything but 6 then.
All right.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller to approve the consent agenda with item 6 pulled, seconded by Commissioner Furstner. Let's vote on that. All right, item six. Let's do that separate. It's the approval of the community grant program. Do I hear a motion?
Well, do we want to hear what the, well, the issue
she,
is?
She's abstaining is what.
Oh, I see.
That's okay. All she's doing, right?
All right.
Yeah, I can't vote on item number
six. She can't vote.
Oh, okay.
She's on
board.
I
have conflicts.
All right. Okay.
So what I need is a motion.
I'll
separately.
Make a motion then that we approve item six.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller with Commissioner Wilson abstaining and seconded by Commissioner Grogan. And with any more? Anybody else? No more? Let's vote. Motion carries with Commissioner Wilson abstaining. All right. First reading of ordinance adopting amendments to the city charter to be placed on the 2018 municipal election ballot. City Clerk Melody City.
This is just the first reading of ordinance title for the adopting amendments to the city charter that will be placed on the 2008 municipal election ballot.
Do we still need to go here?
No, not on this one. All right, this is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, proposing certain amendments to the City of Ocoee Charter, providing for an amendment to the Charter to remove time period for designating independent auditor, providing for an amendment to the Charter to establish term limits, providing for an amendment to the Charter to provide 12 months for mayor and commissioners to be elected in the event of vacancy, providing for an amendment to the Charter to require future city managers to reside in the city limits, providing for an amendment to the charter to establish 4-year terms for mayor and commissioners, providing for an amendment to the charter to require city commission review amendments proposed by charter review commission and adopt recommendations of charter review commission, providing for an amendment to the charter to update districting commission to meet every 10 years, allow for alternate members and require removal of member after 3 absences, providing for an amendment to the charter to require districting commission and charter review commission to have alternate members and to provide for removal of members after 3 absences, providing for a referendum for approval or rejection of the proposed amendments by the electors of the City of Ocoee at the March 13, 2018 general election, providing for and authorizing further acts to implement this ordinance, providing for severability and conflicts, providing an effective date.
All right, and then we will do the second reading and public hearing date is scheduled for October the 3rd, 2017. We need to address it. We'll be back on October the 3rd. All right. First reading of ordinance adopting the new boundaries for the commission districts of the City of Ocoee. City Clerk.
This item is also a first reading of ordinance. It's for the adopting of the new boundaries, which was presented to you all on August 15th and was going to be brought forward.
This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, relating to geographical boundaries for single-member city commission districts, amending Section 5-21 of Article 2 of Chapter 5 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Ocoee in order to change the geographic boundaries of the single-member city commission districts, providing for delivery to the Orange County Supervisor of Elections, providing for severability, providing for codification, providing an effective date.
All right. Same thing, second reading and public hearing date scheduled for October the 3rd, 2017 at the regular city commission meeting, 6:15. All right, going to public hearing number 15, Arden Park North 3A and Amenity Center Preliminary Final Subdivision Plan, PSP, FSP, case number LS 2017-02. City Planner Rumor.
All right, yeah, for the record, Mike Rumor, City Planner. This is the preliminary final subdivision plan for Arden Park. We have two items, Arden Park 3A and 3B. The general location is shown on the outline of the map. And just wanted to remind you of, if you haven't been out at Arden Park, some of the beautiful work that's out there with the subdivision. The 3A includes the amenity center and 27 lots. The reason for the breaking up the property from 3A to 3B is because of the drainage with St. John's. And so they have a mixture of 27 lots, and then the primary is the amenity center, which includes pool, clubhouse, and amenity rooms for the subdivision. Arden Park Phase 1A is on the south side of Clerico and Ocoee Road. We had 2A and 2B, and now we're working around Lake Sims, and we have 3A is the 27 lots and the amenity center. It's got 65-foot, 55-foot wide lots. They'll be building an addition to the private roads. Arden Park Phase 1 on the south side of Clerico and Ocoee has an existing pool and meeting area, parks, and this is the primary pool meeting area for the north side of the subdivision. With that, I'll entertain any questions.
All right.
This is to go to construction.
I'm going to open it to the public. Anybody in the public have any comments on the issue, Arden Park North 3A and Amenity Center, preliminary plan? Anybody in the public? Mr. Mackey. Come on down.
Yeah, I can get there.
Oh, you'll make it.
Yeah, I'm just curious, what's
R.P.
the size? Excuse me, I gotta be recreating here. R.P. Manaki, 1820 Prairie Lake Boulevard.
Lot size?
Yeah, lot size.
There are 10 lots that are 55 feet wide by 120. There are 17 lots 75 feet wide by 120 on this phase.
Okay, that sounds good.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else in the public? No more comments. We'll close it and come to the podium for his comments. Anybody have any comments?
I'm looking forward to it.
Okay. All right, we'll hear a motion. So far.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Motion by Commissioner Keller to approve. You'll hear a second.
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Grogan. No more comments. Let's vote.
And I think it still has an Ocoee address.
All right. Let's go to 16. Yeah. Arden Park North 3B preliminary final subdivision plan.
Yes.
Case number LS-217-07. Mr. Rumer.
And again, this is combining the preliminary and the final. The preliminary is a public hearing. The final is construction documents, so they'll move right around from phase 2B and continue starting building the public roads and the lots and the amenity center. Phase 3B consists of 89 single-family lots. They have a makeup of 45 lots that are 55 feet wide by 120. They have 17 lots 65 feet by 120 and 27 lots that are 75 feet by 120. Again, it'll all be built as one phase, but with the final subdivision and the St. John's permit, it's being divided up today. But again, staff recommends approval.
That it?
That's it.
All right, we'll open it to the public again. Same thing, anybody in the public have any comments? No comments, we'll close it, bring it back to the podium. Hear a motion.
I'll make the motion on this one as well. I believe this is what clears it out then too, correct? This is that'll be the entire Arden Park at that point.
No, you can see from the map, there's a phase 4, phase 5, and possibly this is the school track.
That, okay.
That if something's not decided, could be a phase 6.
All right,
motion made by Commissioner Keller. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Wilson. No more comments, let's vote. Motion carries unanimously. Let's go to item J, second reading of ordinance, public hearing for Ocoee Reserve. Whoop.
17.
Did I miss 17?
Yeah.
Okay. First reading of ordinance amending section 38-6 of Article 2 of Chapter 38 of the City of Ocoee Code of Ordinance relating to hours of on-premise sale of alcohol. I shouldn't miss that.
This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, relating to hours for on-premise sale of alcoholic beverages, amending section 38-6 of Article 2 of Chapter 38 of the City of Ocoee Code of Ordinances, providing for severability, providing for codification, providing an effective date.
All right. Let's open it up to the public. Has anybody got any comments? No comments. All right, move it back to the podium. Just first reading, I'm sorry. We're right back at the public hearing. Yeah, we'll be voting, reading on this again on Friday. Well, no, September, October the 3rd. Second reading, October the 3rd. All right, thank you. All right, now we're going to go to 18. Second reading of ordinance for Ocoee Reserve, a.k.a. Silver Star Road, Planned Unit Development, PUD, annexation of PUD, rezoning land use plan, preliminary and final subdivision plan. City Planner.
We have a lot of items tonight for this project. Typically, you have the rezoning, and then a little while later, you have the preliminary if they combine the final. This one has an annexation ordinance and a rezoning ordinance that'll have to be read. This is a property off the, on the east side of the city, off Silver Star Road. It is on the south side of Silver Star Road. It is eligible for annexation under Florida law, as is adjacent to the city on multiple sides, on the south and the west and the north side. That makes it eligible. It is currently in the county and has agricultural zoning, and it is, I have an aerial here, wants to show up, but it's heavily treed with pine trees. The proposal is to annex the property in to the city limits and rezone it to PUD, Plan Unit Development. It's just under 11 acres, and it's for a single family subdivision, 43 lot. When we initially started this process, there was a builder involved and took it to planning and zoning and then stopped the process. And there's a new builder, Avex Homes, that we're happy to have on board. Avex finished out the Weston Bay townhomes development. They fixed some issues out there and built out the rest of the townhomes and had such a great time. They looked for land and found this project and developing in the city of Ocoee. So for annexation, it's eligible for annexation. It's low density residential land use, and it would be a PUD zoning. The lot sizes would be 42 and a half foot. This is the last subdivision that we had in the pipeline before we kind of talked about, discussed not bringing forward any small lot subdivisions for a while. So this was the last one in the pipeline for that. With regards to zoning, it's Plan Unit Development. It has a land use plan. There's my aerial, finally showed up. It has a PUD land use plan, which creates the zoning criteria with the lot size in the subdivision, 43 lots. There'll be public roads built to city standard. There is a tot lot. There's a lift station tract. This property, in order to develop, actually has to run, it receives water on the west side, but for sewer, they have to run from this point all the way down around the corner, across the road, and down the old Winter Garden Road to reach our sewer system. As I said, 43 lots, and in your packet is the subdivision plan. So we will be actually, first item will be annexing, giving it the zoning, and then approving the preliminary final site plan. We can have a pre-construction meeting, break ground, and build some more homes out there. With that, I'll entertain any questions.
You want to read that?
I will.
Okay, so the first item is the second reading on the annexation ordinance. This is an ordinance of the City of Ocoee, Florida, annexing into the corporate limits of the City of Ocoee, Florida, certain real property containing approximately plus or minus 10.91 acres, located at 8600 Silver Star Road, pursuant to the application submitted by the property owners. Finding said annexation to be consistent with the City of Ocoee Comprehensive Plan, the Ocoee City Code, and the Joint Planning Area Agreement, providing for and authorizing the updating of official city maps, providing direction to the city clerk, providing for severability, repealing inconsistent ordinances, providing for an effective date.
All right, we'll open it to public hearing for anybody with any comments. Mr. Min. All right, we'll start with Mr. Menacki. We'll go up to.
What's the depth of the lot?
I need my readers. 115. The 42 and a half foot by 115. Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Don't forget, Mr. Burnett, fill out that form before you leave. Next.
Good evening. My name is Tom Daly. I'm an urban planner with Daly Design Group at 913 North Pennsylvania Avenue. I'm here on behalf of Avex, and we're the ones that prepared the PUD documents. You know, we're happy that we've received staff support and P&Z support, and we're here just to really answer any questions that you might have.
All right, thank you. Haven't seen you in a long time.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Forms are not available.
They're not available? We got them right up here, though. Next. Yes, sir.
Well, good evening. I'm Sean Cohane from 2440 Old Scott Boulevard, so right in that west corner under the development. I'm glad you guys are here. My questions are simple. One is really aesthetic. If those pine trees that we see in the photo, if any of them on that, there'll be any kind of a buffer between one subdivision and the other, between the Temple Grove Estates that would be right to the south of the whole development. That's the first question.
Sure.
Do you want to ask both?
I sure, of course. The second question is, and I think I see the answer if there was more than one access, you know, entry point and exit point or not. It looks to me like you kind of come in on the street off of Silver Star and you would go out in the same spot. There's no other access into it. So I guess the only question left then is, you know, because we have all those trees in our backyard, and if there'll be any left. That's the question.
Yeah, the way that this neighborhood was designed was to leave open space tracks around the perimeter. To the west side of the property, that actually is an old city right-of-way, so that's kind of a buffer tract in and of itself. The pines that are out there, it's all planted pine. It's all in rows, and it was done for silviculture. And so there are some trees that are within that buffer tract. You're talking about up on the south.
Right.
And so anything within that buffer tract will remain.
Oh, okay.
So I don't think it's 100%.
Sure.
But I've walked that line. Sure. And I probably looked in your backyard. I apologize. But in either case, anything within that buffer tract is going to be, the trees are going to remain. And there's a handful in there. The tract along Silver Star Road, with given grading, we're going to be saving some of the pine trees up in the front along there, too. So, does that answer your question?
It does answer.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Would you please fill out a form also?
I shall.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I think you need to come up here. I don't think there's anything.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, now we've got to do the motion. I got to have a motion for
the annexation
first.
Yeah,
second reading of annexation ordinance.
Yeah, it seems I got a lot going on in my district this month.
I was just going to say, I think it's in yours.
So I'll make a motion to approve the annexation.
All right, motion made by Commissioner Keller to for the annexation ordinance. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Wilson. All right, no more comments. Let's vote. Motion carries. All right. Now we need to
rezone. Make a motion to rezone.
Let me read this.
He's got to read it. Sorry about that.
This is an ordinance
Jumping
of the
ahead.
City of Ocoee, Florida, changing the zoning classification from Orange County A1 to Ocoee Planned Unit Development on certain real property containing approximately plus or minus 10.91 acres located at 8600 Silver Star Road, pursuant to the application submitted by the property owners, finding such zoning to be consistent with the Ocoee Comprehensive Plan, providing for and authorizing the revision of the official city zoning map, repealing inconsistent ordinances, providing for severability, providing an effective date.
All right, we're going to open the public hearing. Anybody have anything to say in the public as far as rezoning ordinance? Anything on the public for rezoning ordinance? All right, we'll close it, bring it to the podium.
I'll make a motion to approve the rezoning ordinance.
Second.
Motion made by Commissioner Keller for the rezoning ordinance, seconded by Commissioner Wilson. Any more comments? Not, let's vote. You don't have anything. Jesus. All right. You don't have anything to read on this?
Yeah, not just the preliminary final subdivision plan.
All right.
Just
open to the public. Anybody in the public have any comment on the land use plan, preliminary final subdivision plan? Nobody? All right, we'll close and come back to the podium. Do I hear a motion?
And I'll make a motion for the land use plan preliminary final subdivision plan.
All right, motion made by Commissioner Keller for land use plan and preliminary final subdivision plan. Here, second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Wilson. No more comments, let's vote.
Welcome to the neighborhood.
All right, before we go to, that's regular agenda, we have no more staff items, do we, Rob?
No, I just need to check on something. I may ask for a minute at the end.
Huh?
I may have something. I might ask for a minute.
I'm going to I want to bring up a, before I go to comments, I want to bring up, I'd like to ask Rob and the staff to go ahead and work on our, look at the traffic lights and have, go ahead and do, talk with whoever you got to talk with, go ahead and proceed with that. We can do it early, right? I know the contract ends up in December.
Oh, the red light cameras, yes. Yes.
Go ahead, and we need to give consent, go ahead and look at that and come up with a...
Yeah, I think when we had talked about it, we need to come up with a new RFP, and yeah. So we need to start working on that.
Do we have to have an RFP?
I could look into that. Maybe Scott can...
Yeah, does that expire in December?
December.
Yeah. December. We can take a look at it. I believe it does require an RFP, if we're going to do that, we've probably got to get started on it.
Well, I thought we didn't have to have, but if we do have to have, can you find out yep. or do we have to have? So, all right. Rod, do we have to have an RFP?
We had looked at it before. We had talked about, it's coming back to me now, we had talked about actually having to go out for an RFP. We may propose something to the commission. We think we could piggyback on possibly the city of Apopka's contract.
Okay.
Because they just renegotiated. It's a better deal than we have right now. And as of this point, we feel we might be able to get a better deal by if they're willing to piggyback on Apopka versus yeah. go okay. out and do
it. As long as it saves us money, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And we'll bring that forth soon.
Can I ask a question on that? Are we going to, we considering adding different lights? Will 50 be done by then to where we're going to be able to?
Yeah, and that's something, you know, we have a list out there of additional lights that we'd like to put on, and we could really do that at any time. We don't have to do that just at budget time, after we do that, it's going to take a couple months to have the engineering done and the new lights installed, but you can consider that at any point.
Okay.
Yeah, that was a good question because mm-hmm. I think there's problems getting it permitted through the things. It'll take a little while with all the...
Yeah, if there's any that we want to add, we can pretty much do that at any point.
Yeah.
We have to retrain a lot of people coming out of Blackwood and 15 and everywhere else because they've gotten where they aren't, abiding, I believe, by right turns.
Right turn on.
Yeah,
as long as they're under 11 miles an hour, anyways.
Yeah, well, that don't happen either.
Okay.
All right. I'll start with the comment. You want to go ahead and talk?
I checked. I'm okay. I don't do
comment,
anything.
Commissioner Keller.
None additional, Mayor. Thank you.
Commissioner First.
No more.
Commissioner Wilson.
Yes, just like to say again, I think I'd like to say what everyone said in the beginning, thanking the residents for being so patient. It's doesn't do much for our mental health when you're driving down the street and you can't get through the street because of the debris, but we're going to work as hard as we can, and we just went through a horrific storm, and I got to comment that the citizens did a great job. I think we were well prepared, and we just don't like the aftermath. The other aspects, Rob, I wondered if I was presented by, it was presented to me that downtown, the wires downtown, I guess they received comments, some of the residents did, regarding the old wires that are downtown that Duke Energy had a problem with. Is there any way we can pursue that and find out if that is an issue? This one resident let me know that there was some problem with the old wires. They were so old, I guess they're ancient in the downtown area, and
yeah, if you could get with me tomorrow. I've not heard that issue up to this point, but I'm sure a representative with Duke, I can get in touch with her easily enough, and I just need to understand the issue better, so if you just give me a call.
Well, they mentioned that the wires were so old down there that I guess they were having problems with them, and Duke was having problems with them, and I guess just bringing it to their attention to the people, the powers that be, that, we don't want to anticipate future storms, but when all you hear about them brewing in the Atlantic there, we're always concerned. And we had so many outages, which the whole state did. It wasn't just us. And we got calls, and our residents, we thank you for being so patient. It was out of our control, but it was hot. So thank you. And I think that's one question we may have to talk to. Debbie Clements may be the one to address it with, but. So now, I think after it's all over, we need to address some of these issues.
That.
Thank you.
Yes.
That's it. Thank you.
All right. I don't really have
any. Brogan?
Who? I about forget you. You good? How about you? You want to talk?
No, I'm good.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, meet us back here on October 3rd. Thank you.